whole idea of courses of action is a huge military distortion. You see, courses of action are extremely important and useful tool of thinking and learning when you do tactical planning. And planning in our case is always and always tactical. There's no planning at the operational or strategic level. Planning is a way of thinking that very much serves the purpose of action. And action is tactical. I mean, it is true that an operation comprises of multitude of actions conducted by units and formations and whatever elements, but action is the realm of tactics. Operations is something different. It's the realm of the abstract that link all actions mentally into something holistic, coherent, etc., etc. So you do courses of action, develop courses of action when you do tactical planning, because both yourself and the enemy are obeying physical, very much physical rules, physical laws, physical principles. I mean, there's a lot of uncertainty there's no uncertainty actually in the world of tactics. Everything is certain in terms of thinking. There's a big element of randomness, but everything in terms of thinking, you are capable of addressing every issues. You may not know exactly when, where exactly it will appear or you will meet it, but you know exactly, you can know exactly, you can cover exactly every element and building in your mind. Moreover, both yourself and the enemy are obeying the same laws, physical laws. I mean, if you're higher, you see better and you very much dominate your rival. If you're bigger in terms of size and firepower, well, you have better success. And this, all this has been very much covered in the past. So the whole idea of courses of action as a tool of tactical planning aims to very much create of a space of probability which gives the tactical operator, enables him to overcome the issue of randomness. If you have done your job properly, each course of action creates a pole or a boundary serves to bound the space of probability within which the tactical player, the tactical actor, will very much hit random occurrences. But since he has framed this broadly enough through the use of courses of action, he will be able to find his way easily, very quickly, identify or observe the situation, frame it quickly, and then go and act. I mean, do the OODA loop and then go and act. So courses of action is a way of framing a space of orientation which covers, I mean, the various probabilities which a tactical actor may hit or may confront while acting.
So at the tactical level, what you're saying is that the planning, the courses of action, those processes which are inductive and deductive logics, they're analytic in nature, those are good at solving tactical mazes, because there's so many probable things that could happen, say in this room with physics and bullets and speed, and that's there. But what we are guilty of at the operational level, where there is just the illusion of the maze.
At the operational, and when we talk about operational level, we are talking about design. Again, in the IDF, that's our approach. Design, operations, and systems are all, I mean, one entity, one it's a unity. I mean, it's systems, the logic of creating, it's the syntax, the grammar of creating logic. Operations are the formal manifestation of this logic. Yeah, systems, operations, and
design. You said systems, operations, and design.
And design, of course, is the way of creating an alternative world. You see, tacticians are not supposed to create an alternative world.
They're
operating in the existing world with the existing tools, with the existing elements and instruments. There's a level of randomness which they have to cover in their mind, but it's not an alternative world. And there's nothing uncertain about that world. A designer creates an alternative world that links together into a system, a coherent system that he creates in his mind, all the various operations taking place in space and time, and executed by various units. So you can create in your mind only one single alternative world. You cannot create. You see, when you are relating to a certain emergence, which you are trying to rationalize systemically, identify the strategic potential for transformation and change, and translate it into a set of operations or an operation. This unity is the, you see, from the beginning to end, the alternative world. You cannot create a variety of alternatives. There's no way of, like in tactical planning, there's no way in which you can create several or a variety of alternative worlds. You can create only one frame. Because if there's a way to create an alternative frame, which means that there's only room for one frame. Not only for each individual, but for the entire design team. Making a common mental effort. We cannot, if there's an alternative, you can create only one alternative to the existing, and you cannot create various alternatives, because each alternative makes irrelevant the previous alternative. So the whole idea of courses of action is wrong.
Yes.
I mean, totally wrong. Design cannot be based on this method.
Analytic tools.
Exactly.
Tools.
That's an analytic tool.
Rejected by synthetic thinking.
And design is a synthetic tool. It's a tool of creating something that does not exist, and you can create only a single creation. There cannot be several creations. Okay, so this is a huge mistake, and again we see it in the various materials and
like national defense strategies that have nothing but planning language and the metaphors.
I know.
It's all tactical.
It's tactical. It's all tactical. Again, you see when we do design, we are identifying paradoxes, and the whole idea of design is very much to deal with, to solve the paradoxes by from the middle, from the median. What you have just described is actually submitting your mind to a paradox without being aware of it. I mean, you cannot plan tactically at the strategic level of functioning. I mean, if you do that, you're wrong, and this is what happens. I mean, we can see this happening.
Do you think this happens unintentionally by modern institutions because the first half of a general officer's career is going to be in the tactical world?
Look, that's the case. Look, every general officer starts, well, in your case, as a platoon or as an officer. No? I mean, every general officer starts as a conscript, as a soldier. and he goes through, I mean, he climbs the ladder until he becomes a general. Most of his time, I mean, biological time and mental time, he spends as a tactician, as a tactical operator, whether it is a single aeroplane, a single helicopter, a single tank, a single APC or infantry fighting vehicle, a squad, platoon, or whatever. But then, you see, the whole education system has to identify when a guy is transiting from this realm of tactical functioning, executing action and operations, actions, to the level of operations. You see, we use the word operation differently from you. And this is why we emphasize, we talk about operation with a capital O. In our case, there are no operations with a small O. And operations with a capital O are the product of design. And they cannot be done. Why? Because every operation is a unique creation, which represents the formal intervention in an alternative world that the designer has created in his mind by using systems grammar and identifying the strategic potential for transformation and etc. And the operation is supposed to exploit this. So again, differences in culture. You see, we use only operations with the capital O, and operations are related to design. And this is why our course, you see, the whole idea of our course is to subversively, to without declaring it, to pass the audience, I mean, the potential audience of generals through a stage of transition, a mental transformation. The whole idea of this year is that the guys who have already been, they got the rank of one star in your case, they already command formations, but they've never been actually educated, they've never developed an identity that focuses singularly on the characteristic of their milieu functioning, the challenges, and of course the elements of functioning. This is what we do here. The whole idea of the course is to give them an experience that very much will let them appreciate that they've actually moved from one level of functioning, one milieu of performance, to another one. And while they are here, they are actually characterizing all this, identifying the challenges, mainly mental, because they're all good commanders, everyone in his own capacity, and develop the elements of functioning, the tools, basically mental tools of functioning. And when they step out of here, they are supposed to be a bit more, well, we expect them to be autarkic. I'm not sure that we've been totally successful in this respect.
Reflective practitioners.
Which means that they are capable of organizing themselves, I mean, they're learning while serving in their command positions to really deal with emerging complexities, organize the learning, organize the thinking, and then develop or design an alternative world, and an alternative operation, which is singular.